Hi, I'm Prateek, a dentist and specialty doctor, and in this video, we're going to be looking at the audit cycle, which is a crucial part of the seven pillars of clinical governance. If you are wanting to see more educational videos and wanting general hints and tips for applications and interviews, then please make sure to subscribe to this channel. So audits are an extremely important part of clinical governance, and they often come up in exams and interviews. So this video should help you provide a well-structured answer if you are asked about audits and how they work. If we look at what an audit is, according to the National Institute for Health and Clinical Excellence, an audit is defined as a quality improvement process that seeks to improve patient care and outcomes through a systematic review against explicit criteria and the implementation of change. Essentially, an audit is a systematic process by which we're examining, reflecting, and then implementing change, ultimately to improve patient outcomes and patient care. We then have the audit cycle. Now, the audit cycle refers to the six parts of an audit and the six steps involved. If we look at these very, very briefly, we first have identifying the problem. So what do we actually want to audit? We then have setting the standard, so identifying the criteria that we want to compare to. We then want to gather information and collect the data. Following this, we want to compare the data to the standard that we've set. From the information we gain from this, we then want to implement change to ideally meet the standard that we want. And finally, the most important sixth step of an audit is to re-audit. And this closes the loop or closes the cycle. Let's now look at each of these steps in a bit more detail. So the first step is identifying the problem. So you may come across something in your day-to-day work that you think, actually, we can improve this for our patients. It may be anything from complications of certain aspects of care. For example, if you're taking teeth out, the complication rates following this. It could be record keeping audits, so there may be lots of information missing from notes, and so you may want to audit this. So that's how we identify a problem, and ultimately we want the solution to improve patient care. We then move on to step two, which is setting the standard. Now the standard may be something that is already available to us. So these may be from existing research or guidelines that are set, for example, a set complication rate from a paper that you've read. Or alternatively, it may be a standard that we are aspiring towards and that we set ourselves. So you may have a vision that you want to achieve. Additionally, in a lot of hospitals, you also then have to register your audit with the central department or the auditing department. You then want to gather the data. Now, often the best way to do this is to create a data capture form or data collection form, and this will have all the information that you want to collect so you can gather it very, very easily and very effectively. It also makes analyzing the data a lot easier when it comes to it. Generally, you will set time periods for when you want to collect data. For example, it may be over a month-long period. So often you could do it at the time, or you could do it retrospectively, looking at back at data that was previously collected. So next, you want to analyze your data and you want to compare it to the set standard. This will then allow us to identify whether we're doing well in comparison to the set standard or whether we're falling short of the standard. We then move on to step five, which is implementing change. So based on our analysis, we'll identify if we're falling short of what we want to achieve. And if we are doing, we need to identify why this is happening. So is it potential problem in terms of how our clinics run? Is it potential problems with software? Is it a variation in how procedures are carried out between clinicians? So we want to try and identify this and implement change in order to meet our standard. And then finally, following this, we then want to re-audit the same information. So you may wait for 6 months or a year and allow this change that you've implemented to take effect. And once this has taken effect, you then want to re-audit the data. So you want to look and see whether your changes have actually worked. So you can then compare your new audit data back to when you first collected and see whether there's an improvement. If there still is an improvement or there's not a sufficient improvement, then you may go through the entire cycle again and implement further change. So that summarizes the audit loop. Now it's really important when it comes to interview questions and exam answers that you have an exam of an audit and also discuss how you went about collecting the data, how you went about discovering that you wanted to do this audit, and what the final conclusions were. So an example of an audit that I have done, I have looked at consent processes for patients, ensuring that consent forms were properly collected, that they were signed, they were done in advance of the procedure, all of these factors. I then went through the audit loop and the audit cycle. I then re-audited to make sure that my changes had actually made a difference. Now let's think about things that we can audit. There are lots of topics, and in your day-to-day life, I'm sure when you're working, you'll think, oh, this should be easier, or these problems shouldn't occur. And those can often give you hints as to what you can audit. A couple of quick examples are patient wait times for clinics, complication rates following procedures. The really basic ones you can do in practice are radiograph quality audits, or comparing to endodontic guidelines and auditing the criteria for endodontic guidelines against what you're doing within your practice. We can also compare to NICE guidelines, for example, extraction of wisdom teeth, and making sure extractions that are done are in line with the guidelines that are set. set. Ideally, when you're answering this interview question, you want it to be a worthwhile audit, not just an easy audit that you've done for ticking the box. And finally, why do we actually audit? Auditing is important. Although auditing can sometimes be a long, drawn-out process, it's a really important part of clinical governance to improve our patient outcomes and our patient care. Because if we didn't audit, we may not necessarily identify issues that are going on, and therefore we would never implement change to try and improve on these. Audits are also a requirement for training and development. As a trainee, if you're going through a training process, auditing is crucial for this. So this video should have provided you with a good overview of what an audit is and what the audit cycle involves, as well as a couple of hints and tips in order to gain the most from your exam and interview questions. I hope that you can now create a well-structured answer if you are asked about this topic. As always, if you found this video useful, please like, comment and subscribe, and do share it with others. If you do want other videos doing, please make sure to let me know either through a comment or on one of the social media handles. My recommendation in this video is Dr. G's Toothpix, which is an excellent website if you're wanting to improve your knowledge regarding radiographs and interpretation of them. There are a huge number of examples of various pathology and also tutorials on how to understand these radiographs. So please make sure to check the website out. Until the next video, take care.